It's a dense day. We have visitors who are here today. We have a meeting right after this because we haven't really jumped on the now probably a little bit late CAPRO issues. So if you are involved in the CAPRO project, we're going to just take 10 minutes at the most, 5 to 10 minutes after this. Stay here, and Audrey and I and Nick, we're going to just work out a few details. Maybe we can work out a few things quickly. If not, we're going to be setting up the time that we feel is comfortable to actually sit down and really work out a few more details. There are just a few logistics between the university and MOCA that have to be worked out in a timely manner so we can move forward, and we need to do that. Also, I know you're all aware of this, but the all grad meeting was bumped. I'm going to go to New York this weekend, so it was going to be Friday. It's now April 4th. So we're all going to be meeting on April 4th, and on that agenda will be inclusive of a number of things going on. I don't think there are any other specific announcements. Was there anything else that anyone, since we're all here, because we haven't been together for a little while, to bring up? Okay.
More
shows
opening tomorrow night.
More shows opening tomorrow night, right?
Woo!
And Maya on the following Friday, and I think that, and I'll mention it again next week since Maya's unorthodox move from Thursday to Friday, so we just all remember the Party Friday.
Party Friday
with Maya. The other, it slipped my mind. Okay, it might come back. Matt Green is one of the nicest people I know. Although I haven't witnessed this myself, but I had to mention this, I do understand that he's both a fantastic cook and a highly skilled snowboarder. I got the snowboarding information from Benjamin Weissman, who is his snow partner. What I have experienced both in studio and in institutional environments is Matt's ongoing investigation of subjects and styles that define his practice. Such as horticulture, vintage pornography, horror films, fairy tales, 19th century symbolist art, and modernism, to name a few. Matt's complex representational paintings open up a phantasmagoric doorway that ranges from magical location of nocturnal mushroom gardens to the erotic location of fetish poses and the complicated space of the transgendered figure as subject. In his newest works, rich washes of color and bleeding expanses of black transport the viewer into Lewis Carroll-like nightclubs, with figures posing, dancing, cavorting, and copulating that evoke life, death, and sexual slippage. Green has had solo exhibitions at Perez Projects Los Angeles and Deitch Projects New York. Recent museum exhibitions include Eden's Edge, 15 LA Artists at the UCLA Hammer Museum, in Los Angeles, and Swallow Harder, selections of the collection from Ben and Eileen Crone at the Fry Art Museum in Seattle. Green's work is in the permanent collections of the Museum of Modern Art New York, the Art Gallery of Ontario in Toronto, and the Hone Art Museum in Tehran, Iran. Reviews of his work have appeared in Art Forum, Flash Art, Frieze, and New York Times. Matt Green was born in 1972 in Atlanta, Georgia, and he received his BFA from the Atlanta College of Art. He recently relocated, he just moved from Los Angeles after living here for what, 10 years to New York, which was a big change in Matt's life, and he is represented there by Deitch Projects. Please join me in introducing Matt Green.
Thank you, Charlie. That was amazing intro. I'd love to find some Lewis Carroll nightclub to go to. So I want to really quickly show you work from starting. This is a piece from maybe 5 years ago, and mostly focus on work from the last year, and talk about how my work has changed, and I've gotten, I feel like I got rid of a lot of things that were unnecessary smoke screens that I had put up to sort of protect myself from exposing things that I was embarrassed to show about myself. So I have this like rich fantasy life that revolves around the idea of
living in an all-female universe. So I was making all these, like, so this is a drawing of 666 female guitar players. You can count them. They're really tiny, like this is done with a 000 repeatograph, and I spent maybe 3 months of 10 hours a day drawing and gave myself tendonitis and never wanted to make a drawing like this again. But so I'm always interested in scenes where women mock male phallic power, where men are absent or subjugated by women or are forced to become women or something like that. And I want all of this to take place in nature. Like my idea is that this is that what I mean, art for me is the intersection between a fantasy space in the physical world, and like, of course, that is laden with tension, and it can never be like an artist that I have gotten a lot of inspiration from. You know, obviously, as you look through my work, is Hans Bellmer, and something that's, you know, the thing that's interesting to me about Bellmer's work is in the failure of the work to be a 3-year-old girl with 8 legs. And 20 breasts, you know what I mean? Like, what's interesting is the tension between the fantasy and the physical world. So I like being in, like, in this in-between state. And so in this drawing, there's all of these figures are sort of merging into a landscape. There's ambiguity between genders, there's ambiguity between life and death, there's ambiguity between, you know, what's a fungus, what's a human, what's a plant. And anytime formally two different types of organisms or two people or whatever can, you know, can share a line in the way that the thing is drawn, that is really appealing to me. I like the idea of slippage and not being able to define what something is, and I think that I sort of I grew up having such a hatred of minimalism and feeling like it was such a lie to say, for art to say, well, here's a theory, and I'm gonna make something in the physical world that so strictly adheres to this theory that that there's no room for it to be in between states. Like for example, like a sculpture of a cube is nothing other than a sculpture of a cube, right? That's something that I feel like I don't understand how you can live in that space, because my experience in the world is that in spite of whatever theories we have, that there are we're forced to live in the, like, we do live in the physical world, but there are things that go wrong and decay and. So I liked making art that was sort of about this like ambiguous zone between you know, the human world and the natural world, and seeing human culture and especially sexual fetishes as being as coming from nature, like the way that I used to spend a lot of time talking about ideas in science, and I actually don't think that that's very interesting, and I think that we should just talk about art. But so I was really interested in how, like, you know, how plants and animals change forms, and how plants have chemicals that cause people to hallucinate. And I'm so interested in the intermeshing and the complicated interrelationships between different organisms. So I wanted to make paintings that, you know, sort of have these geometric spaces. I don't think of them so much as a critique of modernism as just sort of these gridded spaces are like, maybe you can barely see this in the texture of this painting. There's like a receding gridded floor. So I wanted to make pieces where the structure of the painting, like I always like seeing, like when you look at like an X-ray of a Renaissance painting and you see the underpainting and the grid, which is like the theatrical space on which the illusionist pictorial space is taking place. I like sort of fucking with that space and saying, okay, I'm gonna create this stage and like make this gridded space, and then all kinds of crazy shit is gonna grow on it and it's gonna fall apart and things are gonna reproduce. And it's gonna be an environment where there are gonna be times of like a cataclysmic event, which the things have to find some way to adapt to that inhabit that space. So I always, when I start making a piece, I never know what it's going to be, and I will sort of say, I'm creating a population here, and here's some event that they have to adapt to in order to survive, which I think is like, you know, that struggle is like a beautiful thing to me. This is a pretty big painting. This is maybe 12 feet tall and 15 feet wide or something on three separate panels, where there's sort of like these, you know, a few larger figures, but then the whole thing is like made up of this network of, every one of these is like a tiny figure. There's like thousands of little figures on there. You can sort of see at the top, like every one of those is like a 1-inch tall person drawn on a piece of paper from a photograph, which is either found in pornography or a photograph that I took of myself basically in the studio if there was a certain body position that I wanted. Here's a more directly fetishistic and less natural, with less of a natural setting. Like I feel like I had sort of, realized that I was, a big part, that once I had sort of said, okay, well, I'm interested in these things taking place in nature, and that you know, we're animals and that we have a complex set of requirements for our sexual reproduction, which become more complex when we're not struggling to find food. And I felt like maybe like there was a point at which like involving all these like plants and mushrooms and things was like actually just a smokescreen that I was creating, or like a ruse, and what I actually wanted to see were like these like to like find some way to, that what was more interesting to me was that conflict between like my ability to imagine something and its inability to exist in the world. So here's a piece that this is maybe the first piece that I did that was directly and only made from photographs that I took of myself. And so here's some of the photos from that. Like I set up a video camera and like staged all these sort of classical poses. This painting is sort of loosely based on Uccello's Battle of San Romano, which was supposedly like one of the first paintings to, it was, you know, an early use of one-point perspective where, you know, there's all these lances and stuff and they're lying on the ground and they all are pointing in the direction of a vanishing point. So I was interested in this idea, but it's also like, early Renaissance painting is really interesting because like, they started thinking of like, the painting space as being a gridded space and like, but I'm interested in the period where they haven't quite figured it out and things are awkward and primitive. This is a painting called The Mushroom Hunters. I was living in Berlin at the time and I had found all of these like raincoat fetish magazines that would have Like, there would be no nudity in them. They would just be pictures of people wearing raincoats, but they were sold in porn shops. And I thought that seemed like the most perverse thing that I had ever seen in my life. And I couldn't help but think that, as an avid mushroom hunter, I get really excited when it's raining, and I want it to, like, so when you go outside and it's raining, there's like this whole different world is out there. Like, fungus comes to life in the rain. Like, even in Los Angeles, even in the summer, there's thousands of fungi all over the place, and if you go out in the rain, you can see these things like busting up through the ground. And I couldn't help but feel, the more time I was spending outside and, you know, watching fungi reproduce, I couldn't help but feel a certain empathy for the mushroom, you know, winding its threads together and growing up through the ground and like making this giant elaborate thing to like, you know, distribute its spores. And I couldn't help but think, you know, that on a certain level, the mushroom is really taking a great sexual pleasure in absorbing rain and growing up through the ground. So I thought it was kind of interesting to like combine this like these like raincoat fetish images with like this idea of like mushroom hunting. And there's actually some hidden mushrooms in there, but they're really tiny. They're hard to see. This is a painting that was started with, like, the germ of this painting was like this idea that there are flowers which cannot live without being pollinated by insects, so they do all these different things to enlist insects to come and like, well, so there's like a whole variety of plants that simulate mating signals of insects and to enlist insects to come and have sex with the flower, and it gets covered in pollen, and then it goes on to another flower and pollinates it, and that's how the plants reproduce. They say something like the wings of insects could also be called the wings of flowers. Like, I was interested in the complete interdependence of all these organisms, and so sort of like my like speculative idea going into this piece was, well, what if there was a flower that was tricking people into having sex with it to reproduce itself? And then my next show, this was from 2005 at Dutch Projects. I kind of just wanted to say, I wanted to make work that was more directly about, you know, male fantasies, voyeurism. This piece is called Our Idealized Invisibility, which sort of comes from Laura Mulvey did the audio commentary to this film, Peeping Tom, which is a British movie that came out the same year as Psycho. And it was about a guy who went around stalking prostitutes with a camera and would then, like, on his camera tripod, there was like a knife that would come out, and he would like stick the knife into their throat while the camera was running, and the whole thing was like, you know, about the violence of the male gaze, like, you know, to what extent the cinema and photography is based in a desire to fix women as images. And this idea of like fetishistic clothing is like, you know, turning the woman's body into an impenetrable barrier onto which fantasies are projected, like to turn the woman into a screen. So formally, like, this painting is made up of like, I mean, I was sort of thinking of it as like a movie theater, or like, so there's like all this stuff around, you know, a movie screen shape with all these transparent images. images of women and gazing back at a viewer which is presumed to be invisible. That's something that the line from Laura Mulvey was something like, that what the voyeur actually desires is invisibility. And that's like a big part of what the cinema is. So I was just really interested in this, like, I went to art school in the 90s and was very familiar with feminist theory, and, you know, as I was saying, my sort of fantasy life revolves around living in an all-female universe and wanting to mock male displays of power. At the same time, I have this great love of, you know, the history of painting, and I think it's a really beautiful art form. And in the 90s, there was so much of a critique of painting as being this only male thing that, like, subjugated women. And the thing that's complicated for me is, like, so I can critique this idea of the male gaze, and yet I'm male and I have eyes, so I'm there's a point at which it's like I'm interested in this tension between, like, you know, the ideal and the reality, like the fantasy and the physical world, bio and the ideal. So this is a painting that I hired a fetish model to come and pose with a sword, and, you know, sort of directly parody the, like, male fear of castration, and to, like, parody the idea of, like, the sword as a phallic symbol. But in this, and it was funny because people always thought of this space as being like a nightclub or something, and I actually always thought of it as like in science fiction movies where there's a like a holograph room or something that's like is like a gridded room that you go in, and then all of a sudden, like, this holograph appears, which is your fantasy life. That's more of what I was thinking of. I like to leave it open, and I like to not be didactic, and again, what I really want is to make an ambiguous space that is not so easily definable. And so there was also a point where I was like, so this is like a photograph on that painting was based on. So I was doing these photo shoots, and there's a certain point at which I thought, well, so I'm working with models, and I actually would like to, there's a point at which I want to just I have all these things going on in my life, and I'm trying to understand by making art, and I started wanting to be sort of more directly. So sort of like this is the point at which I started transitioning into making work that was mostly based on photographs of myself, my wife, and a couple of my closest friends, and not have models that I didn't have a relationship with. So when I had this show, Roberta Smith said that I was making porn for hedge fund managers with a penchant for lap dances. And I was like, well, actually, that's not really true. I'm actually trying to find a way to, like, communicate with my wife and, like, have a relationship in a way that that doesn't make me be the, like, subjugating male with the violent gaze. Again, because I have this fantasy of, like being in an all-female universe, like, the a P appeal of witches to me is not like women are evil and, you know, cast bad magic spells on you. I actually have like always been like sexually attracted to witches, and I like the idea that they, and again, like the broomstick again is like this like, you know, thing that like mocks the penis, and you know, the history of witchcraft is that, you know, on the one hand, they would like, in Europe, there would be women that had, you know, like an ecstatic relationship to their environment and like knew which plants to use for healing. And also that there is, that they knew how to use psychoactive plants. And so there's, you know, this whole theory that there was a, like a witch's salve that they would like, that was a concoction of various psychedelic plants, and that they would like apply it to vaginally using like a rod or a broomstick or something. So that's sort of this like the idea that all of these things came from. But so I wanted to make paintings that showed like this, you know, these, on, which are on one hand purely fetishistic images of maybe of male desire, I mean, but also that they would be like, that the, what my desire is rooted in the natural world, or women having power and like an ecstatic relationship to their environment. I felt like these, that it was so, it seemed to me so taboo for a man to make a painting of a woman in any sexual way, that I felt like it was, that it was like maybe the only interesting thing that I could do as an artist was to like confront that, that thing that was so, again, maybe, I mean, the world has changed since the 90s, but sort of my foundation thinking about art was, you know, the most evil thing that a man could do is make a painting of a woman that showed any desire or fear or any of the complicated emotions that we actually experience in the world. And I just felt like, well, I'm gonna, you know, I'm gonna take the chance of exposing myself and say, you know, like, I do have this complicated relationship to images of women, and I don't think that art should be didactic and only theoretical and only be like, to act only according to a theory, but to sort of think about art as a complicated space where that's the intersection between this theoretical world and the messiness of the physical world. This is a detail of a two-part drawing. Which was the result of a photo shoot where I hid in another room dressed up as a witch, and the model, who was my wife, didn't know that I was gonna do this, but I came out dressed up as a witch, and like, because I wanted to see her like actually be surprised and scared, or to have like a real reaction to something and to not be, for the body movements to not be entirely staged by me. This is called Surrender, part one and part two. So then in the second version of the drawing, the witch has been turned into a mushroom.
Has she been dressed up like a French maid doing with the same intention?
Yeah.
To trick you and you didn't know it?
That's a good question. Anyway, so I wanted to like, no, I mean, I sort of like, I mean, we sort of picked out the costume together, and, but I wanted to like, I didn't want to say like, oh, this is something that I desire and I'm cool or something. Like, I actually wanted to say, this is something that I'm so embarrassed that I'm desire that I want to like, you know, humiliate myself in the process, and like, so the joke's on me, and I got turned into a mushroom. Again, women playing guitar. These are all men. So along with this idea of wanting men to be humiliated and to live in this all-female universe is like transgender and cross-dressing. So in my fantasy all-female world, if you're a male, has to exist in it by becoming a woman. The thing that's funny though is like, so when I did this, I know that that's a man in a dress, but no one else knows that. And I felt like that there was just this huge barrier that I was like I really wanted to like, I really wanted to put myself in. It's tricky to know like how much to reveal of yourself, but I actually had a pretty strong desire to show like that I wasn't just interested in making porn and subjugating women, and that I was actually, in a lot of my paintings, I was taking pictures of myself in a dress, and maybe I still am guilty of having a violent male gaze, but I think that wearing a dress and wanting to be a perceived to experience the world as feminine on a certain level complicates that a little bit anyway. So the next show I did, this was from Perez Projects last spring. I wanted to be a little bit more explicit that it's me. Like, this is a lot more obviously me and my wife than maybe in any previous work. And it was surprising to me how difficult it was for me emotionally to like put this into the world and to, you know, to put my money where my mouth was and actually sort of like humiliate myself. And like my mom came and saw this show and was like, okay, well, that was something I had to do. Like it was actually like, you know, it's traumatic. It was really traumatic on a lot of levels. It doesn't seem like that at all to me now. But like I was talking with Benjamin Weissman about this assignment that Marcia Tucker gave students that was something like do something you were afraid to do or confront a fear or something along those lines. So I made this show that was like, this is called The Punishment. And it's pretty obviously me. And the invitation for the show, you know, was the photographs from this painting. So there would be no confusion that it was me and that I was like, you know, that my ideas about gender were coming from something that was a lifelong investigation of something totally personal to me, and that I felt like it took me a few years of making art to want to really like expose myself in this way, and these are details. So these are all like drawn from photographs with pencil on the canvas, and then paint is applied onto them.
Could you talk a little bit about why you're so interested in multiple figures, or like so many big groups?
Yeah, I think it's, I mean, on a certain level, it comes from, you know, my first exposure to art was looking at, like, Bosch and Voegele as a kid, and, like, I would just, I would spend hours just staring at these big crowds of, teeming crowds of people, and I think part of it is, like, not wanting it to be, like the product of my individual ego. Like, I like the idea of being, like, I like being in a forest and seeing, like, that there's, like, millions of trees and millions of different organisms all interacting with each other, and I really like to think of myself as being, that's a difficult question. I don't, there's just a point at which I want to see big crowds of people. Like, I like feeling like, I like having the experience of feeling like an ant compared to a giant redwood tree or the ocean or a mountain or a giant mass of people. Like, I like things that are like ego-dissolving experiences. Like, and so maybe, like, part of, like, wanting to be in, like, these big crowds of people is just, like, wanting to, like, not be that the lone artistic genius who, like, has some great theoretical idea or something. Does that make sense?
And then if you painted one person, it's like you'd be replicating.
Yeah. Also, it also has a relationship to, like, film and, like, sort of, like, over the years I've made a lot of videos which I've never shown really, and I feel like I don't understand how to work with film. A lot of my ideas come from film, and, like, maybe there's a desire to have, like, the sense of movement or narrative or showing a sequence of events. These works, you know, starting with the show, I sort of simplified the spaces a lot, and they are sort of like, instead of being figures of various scales sort of all melding together, they're sort of like stacked up. Like, one thing that I think a lot about is, like, in skateboard photography, when they, like, will shoot a sequence of someone doing a trick or something, like, and put the stills together as if it's, like, film stills or, like, Muybridge or something. I just think that's an interesting way of looking at the body that is, basically, I just want to see the groups of the same person. It's also as, like, a hall of mirrors, like, you know, the thing where, like, if you're standing between two mirrors, you can look and it's like you see, like, infinite reflections of yourself or something. It's not any one thing. Like, I mean, nothing in my work, like, actually is, like, intended to, like, mean one thing. It's supposed to be, like, based on associative thinking and not, like, didactic theory-based thinking. So then after the show, I thought, why am I drawing these things? Like, I felt like I was getting closer and closer to making the kind of pictures that I wanted to look at in my mind, or that I didn't feel like I wanted to give myself tendonitis anymore, or, like, the sort of the most unfun part of making art for me was tediously rendering things over and over and over and over again on huge canvases. So I, as an experiment, and the way that I had been making those, you know, like, these paintings, so I would do a photo shoot, and I would take hundreds of photos, and I would put them up on the wall, like, put them all up on the wall, and move them around and sort of edit and compose the painting based on the photographs. And I actually felt like there was a point at which was more interested in looking at the wall of photos than I was at the paint, like that the painting was like sort of like the dead part of it and the active living part was like the photography. So then I finally just made a piece where I started doing that. Like I, in the background of this piece, like maybe there's areas sort of like here where you can see there's like, the background is a grid of photographs of these figures from this photo shoot. And then there are larger and larger, you know, blow-ups. These are all just Xeroxes glued onto the canvas. The lines are just made with tape and the whatever, like varnishes and adhesives I use to glue on, to glue the images onto the canvas, I let drip down. But there wasn't very, I mean, there was basically no application of paint design to render an illusionist space what was originally in the photograph. The, like, the layers of goop and stuff dripping down are just there to glue the images onto the canvas. And this was like a really liberating piece for me. Like I had been wanting for a long time to, I felt like I had this relationship to photography that was not completely fulfilled by only showing drawings and paintings. And on a completely different note, like about the application of paint, there's a point at which, like, I mean, it's not that hard to make a link between the way that the paint is applied and, like, body fluids. And something that is so, like, there's this super perverse art form that I think is, like, unique to our time, like, of internet pornography. There's this whole thing that on, like, amateur porn sites where people will, like, print out a photo that they have, like, so people will put up their amateur porn on the internet, and then people will print out a photo and then ejaculate on the photo, and then take a photo of that and put that up next to the original photo. So there's a point at which I wanted to, like, there's something so dark and disturbing and, like, does point back at that idea of, like, photography as, like, something that is violent towards the female body in some way, or, like, is a stand-in for that. And that is so complicated to me. Like, I thought that was a, I realized that, like, maybe there was a level of my application of paint that was somehow related to that, and maybe I have been trying to play that up as, like, a source of tension. So here's one of the original photos from that painting, where me and my wife and another female friend had, like, this giant stack of black and white clothes, and we sort of, like, took turns taking photos and putting these clothes on each other to sort of make this, like, black, white, positive, negative, male, female amalgamation.
Matt, in regards to what does it feel like for you to kind of maybe just engage, because some of the other photos that you have done seem to be kind of, they really seem to be kind of a process in which you're trying to get source material for your paintings, but on an occasion like this, it could be circumstantial, it could be because it's black and white, but the photograph itself starts to emanate a lot of stuff without having to take part in the painting. Like, do you see a relationship between just, you know, not ever having to take it to canvas, and that this is something of its, you know, of its own merits, specifically like these groups, these black and white groups, because they're really beautiful.
Yeah, and that's, that's exactly what I'm in the middle of doing in the studio right now, and the last things I'll show you are photos which were actually done for a painting which I'm going to show on their own. And this is another painting that, like, this was a painting that started off after making that piece with the photographs, I was like, I just want, you know, I only want to paste these photographs on in 100 thick layers, and as if they were like posters on like a construction site wall, and let them be all super wrinkly and let fluids drip down over them. So that's, I mean, that's what this piece is. Here's another piece, like sort of from that same, that the first piece I showed with the photos was like from last summer, and this is all from like last summer to the present. And here's another piece that's maybe more like in that previous mode of chopping the things up to make as elements to compose some bigger piece. This piece is up at the Armory today. And so in, like in these last few pieces, like, I mean, they're, it's obvious to me, maybe it's not obvious, that, like these are all just me. This piece, I was thinking a lot about that Polanski movie, The Tenant. That, like, if you're not familiar with that movie, it's like this like Kafka-esque story of Roman Polanski moves into this apartment and where this girl had just killed herself and starts hearing voices and eventually starts dressing up like the girl that killed herself and smoking her cigarettes and like eventually jumps out the window to kill himself, fails, and is wearing this frumpy dress and like crawls back up the stairs to jump out the window again to kill himself. Right? And that, which is so complicated and disturbing and interesting to me, that I wanted to, make a piece that was, about my paranoia of taking a photograph of myself in a dress.
What's your relationship to Warhol's photographs of himself dressed as a woman and his sort of use of repetition and deterioration? Because I see a lot of similarity with these silk screening projects, especially the ones that become really repetitious and begin to break down as images, and your use of repetition and these streaking lines.
The person who I really think of is Peter Molyneux, who's like he was a surrealist, and he was a photographer who would take pictures of himself and other people in very specific stockings and shoes and and then cut the photos up and like montage them together so people would have like extra legs and stuff. I probably come more from like I probably think a lot more about like surrealism than pop. Warhol I find so like calculating. And I like it when people are like, I like work that is less self-conscious than that or something. But I mean, of course, that's like, I mean, I'm aware of those and like, Duchamp's female alter ego. So this is the last painting that I made. And there's all these layers of the texture that you're seeing here is like there's these areas where there's like many, many layers of photographs piled on and ripped off, and there's like holes in the canvas, and it's really like has a very heavy texture, and it's like again about like the interface between like the photograph and the physical world, and I'm always like doubting the purity of the photograph to answer your question, Charlie. So the next things that I'll show you are a series of photos that for a painting that I'm working on right now. And the painting actually just turned into a big abstract painting with none of these images in it. So this series that I'm going to show are, I'm printing pretty big, like 4 by 6 feet, and I may or may not like dump a layer of varnish on them, like to like dripping down it, like in that way that I was describing, like people like ejaculating on these photos. Or I might just show like when they're being printed right now. Or I might just show them as photographs. I don't know what I'm going to do. Like I like to reserve the right to not know what I'm going to do. But so I'll just show these 8 images of, I gave these 2 girls a loose set of instructions basically regarding their clothes, gave them both 2 knives and said, I kind of just want you to do whatever you're going to do with 2 knives and high heels. It was an interesting thing that happened was I had like, the power went out in my studio 10 minutes before we started shooting. So the lighting that you see is all like, comes from just light bulbs sitting on the floor coming from extension cords. And I actually think that it turned out way better than the way that I would have lit it. But I liked mocking the idea that women are castrated or the potential castrators of men or something like that. I also wanted maybe this was like one of the photos that I was hoping to get by having their legs be sparkly and pink and the rest of their upper bodies being black, is that you could like get this mass, this like upper body mass that ends in like an ambiguous number of legs. Like I like the idea that that could be like one person with extra legs. That's the last one. So do you guys have more questions?
What do you think about like the photography coming out of Yale in the 90s by a lot of the
like Annie Gaskell?
Yeah, female students of great recruits and that have become very successful.
Yeah, I mean that's a huge influence on me.
And like your relationship, because I think it's really interesting talking about sort of like, you know, this disclosure through your work about something that's really personal and the kind of relationship that female artists have had to finding their own kind of empowerment through the male gaze and either, confrontation of that or a taking up of that in their own way, and then your sort of discussion or attempt to find your own power within that kind of structure.
Maybe this might seem indirect, but I would say that it's not so much that the idea of female photographers as much as I felt like that there are things going on in like in queer art that were so different from the way that people in so-called straight art were thinking about sexuality And like I'm thinking specifically of someone like Eve Fowler or someone who's like documenting sexual practices in, you know, a queer community. I felt like there was such a like, so much risk taking in that work that was so absent from whatever straight mainstream, whatever, like, and I was like, I felt like that there was not, like, I wanted to create this ambiguous zone between these distinctions of gay and straight, and like, that we can like be post that distinction now, and that, like, I like manipulating that boundary of like, but yeah, I mean, I think that, I mean, the reason that I want to photograph or make art about the, you know, potentially embarrassing things about myself or, is like, is totally from the bravery of those, of people, and like, I wouldn't just say women photographers coming from Yale, but like, maybe more like the risks taken in, you know, what has always been labeled as queer art, and saying, let's just talk about art and not like ghettoize it and say, this is queer art, which is a separate thing from straight art. Like, you know what I mean?
Matt, can you talk about like what's happened for you in your process since this period of introducing yourself into the work, because it seems so significant, like, and it looks like it went in, like that last painting you showed that you said is up at the Armory, mm-hmm. sort of the first one where we see a male chest, you know, I mean a
yeah.
biologically male chest, you know,
yeah.
and that's really significantly different than, you know, all of your explorations of dealing with the male gaze,
mm-hmm.
And I'm just wondering if you can talk about the trajectory that you are experiencing right now from putting yourself in drag in the pictures to now this, you know, because it's really different than the something you and I were just talking about recently was how, I mean, the male gaze is something we're actually all sexualized by, and so this kind of search for a femaleness, as I was sort of saying, is futile, you won't find it, there isn't one. We're all, you know what I mean, all of our sexualities post-photography is male, so. If you could talk about where you see that going for yourself.
Well, I have to say that in a lot of those earlier paintings that I showed, like, it is me in drag. And when I would show the work, I would know it, and I would be like sweating at the opening. I'd be like, oh, this is like so embarrassing for me. And people are like, oh, it's like some chicks in a dress, like, you know what I mean? Like, male porn art, you know. And it actually took me getting a bad review to be like, to want to say, to clarify by putting myself in. So I just feel like, I mean, really what I mean, which of course is like liberating and scary, and I just want to, I mean, in terms of the trajectory, I would say that what I want to do is like hack away at my preconceived ideas and find a way to like communicate that kernel of my like whatever it is about me that cannot be narrowly defined in terms of maleness and the male gaze and that stuff. Like, how can I hack it? Like, there's so, like, you build up so much like armor to like present yourself into the world that I just feel like it's not gonna come off overnight, and that what my work is about right now is like trying to hack away at all those things and like find out what, like, you know, what is my actual self. I don't mean that in terms of autobiography, like I mean what is one's by example of doing it to myself. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Or?
Because I was just thinking when you spoke about humiliation that, like, once you had a personal experience of it, either as an artist presenting art, or even as, you know, in relationship to your family or whatever, that humiliation is also a complicated construct of male desire too, and that the woman with the sword actually doesn't get released from her disempowered position in relationship to castration, because castration is still just a male fantasy. And so once you've experienced it yourself, now it seems like the art gets to then change again, because it's probably either the humiliation stays as a fetish, a lifelong fetish, and it's always going to be exciting, or something else personal shifts in it. And I'm just, I was curious about that. Like,
well, that's, I mean,
change?
That's the thing.
Is
like,
is it still humiliating?
That's the thing that is like, I don't pretend to be in a position of self-knowledge to the point where I can predict the future. Like, I have no idea what I'm gonna,
yeah.
Like, the piece that I'm working on right now, I have no idea what, I mean. Like, but I think that it's like, the position that I want to be in is one of willfully not knowing, to say, I don't know, and I don't think that you know either, and that whatever way we present ourselves in the world is a compromise between what we think we are and what we think we want other people to be and what we actually are, and like that all of, like that there's not a point at which you can separate, and that there, that we sort of do live in this like hall of mirrors where everything's fragmented, and like it is so impossible to know what that, you know, real, the kernel of the self, which can't be like discussed in terms of something that already exists as a symbolic mode, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And all I can say is that art is like the place where those things can duke it out with each other, and like that like that the tension of that is what's interesting to me.
I keep thinking about rock and roll, and rock and roll is like this place, especially for males, to like experiment with a kind of ambiguous sexuality. Like I'm thinking of like Aerosmith or something, or like Mick Jagger, as kind of examples of that, and taking it to an extreme with a band like New York Dolls, where it literally men, you know, dressed in very kind of stereotypical, you know, female.
That sort of was my like access point to like androgyny and gender ambiguity. It was through like examples of like, you know, androgyny and rock from the 70s. But then I just like that again, like that was something that I felt like that's like something that's constructed so externally to me, and like that's like something that I wanted to like peel through and like see what was underneath that, and like what's like that's like a, like the glam period of rock is like, you know, something like a, like something from our cultural history and not something from my actual experience with other humans, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So I felt like that was one thing that I was like happy to sort of leave behind as I evolved as an artist. It's like I don't want to make pop culture references, and I want to like think about things and to try and like find a way to rid my mind of thinking about things in terms of pop culture to get to something that's more like real. Or does that make sense?
But even performing itself, is it that in the static image, whether it's a photograph or a painting or a collage, there's something that you can explore further that you can't explore by what you actually perform is. So there's a performance. There's a performance that happens originally, whether it's you with someone you've hired and you're the photographer, or whether it's you're an actor and another person is, even if you have an intimate relationship with them, you're still creating kind of a performance to make a document. That's a place to go to draw a final, you know, piece from.
And you're saying, why don't I just do a performance?
Or is that something you're interested in exploring?
It's actually not. Like, for me, the performance is a private thing, and the artwork is like, it's not purely residue of the performance. It's for me, the performance can only take place in private. Like,
mm-hmm.
Like the only way that I'm gonna let you see my performance is in, and again, like, that's my hesitation to, like, just show a straight photograph, is, like, I actually want to, like, put up a barrier that says, actually, there's no way that you can understand what happened here, and I'm trying to, like, this is the way that I can communicate it with you.
I can relate to, maybe you already addressed this, but it seems that looking, it's kind of a personal question, but looking at it, it seems that your relationship with your wife allowed the development of this trajectory you just described, and I'm wondering if, you know, if you didn't have that cooperation, would you have gotten
it? It's totally crossed my mind, like, that if I was, like, trying to get laid, I would not make the art that I was doing.
Well, I mean, I'm thinking of the sort of collaborative process that allowed you to explore further, and then, but ultimately the paintings are about you. And I'm wondering if, you know, but the foundation of the paintings seems like it's sort of born in a trust and a relationship. And I'm wondering if you find yourself needing to explore that.
I can't separate my thoughts about myself from my relationship with my wife and other friends, and you know what I mean? Like, I think that
I think what I'm getting at is a whole different approach. I mean, one is what you described, the mm-hmm. personal exploration of your inner self, and the other is an exploration of the strength of a relationship mm-hmm. and the possibility that comes from that shared, which is the opposite of isolated.
Right.
And
yeah,
yours seems to be a two-part that's resulted in one product, and you find yourself at all considering bodies of work that might explore the relationship aspect of it.
Well, I mean, I feel like that we learn about ourselves through our relationships mm-hmm. with others, and I'm trying to think of a way that I can separate myself from your equation, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
And that I do try and get, I certainly think of the people that I work with as collaborators, and I certainly get a lot of ideas from them and working with them, and it is about, I mean, it's about my experience of my relationship with other people. But I don't know that I can think of a different mode to make mm-hmm. art in. Like, there's a certain point at which I just sort of make the painting that I'm going to make. Like.
Oh, I got this other image that is completely separate, but, you know, you're born, and then environmentally, you're given, you know, all this secret inner life,
uh-huh.
and at a certain point, you become adult, whenever that is, like 12 or 18 or 28 or 50 for some of us. And then you begin to explore it and deconstruct it, which you've done, and you start to open it up and reveal it back again, so you come back to the beginning of this neutral soul that's mm-hmm. now examined everything that's been laid on. But you're still alive. So at that point, what happens?
Well, I mean, I just think it's like that's an ongoing process, and like, but like, that's my interest in like layering in the paintings, is like that, you know, my experience of life is like, well, sure, I could say just today I've become an adult and I understand myself in a completely different way, and I could also do that in 10, like tomorrow and the next day and the next day, and it would be a completely different experience or a different self that's like partially the same and partially different, partially influenced by interactions that I've had with other people or things that I've discovered about myself or whatever. Like, I mean, I just feel like I don't feel like I can isolate one day that I said I'm an adult now. You know what I mean? But there are these, like, you know, periods of like, there's like static periods, and then there's like tumultuous periods where you have to adapt to your environment. And maybe in my art, I'm a little more interested in like those periods of adaptation than the static periods.
Matt, you've talked about kind of like in the most general terms, kind of two strands, one that is that personal self, and then one that's kind of still seems to play a major role in how any any idea is reconciled. It seems to come from a real respect and attention to painting and particular interests and histories of painting. But kind of taking those two concerns and going back to what Stanya had mentioned, that at that one point when certain subject matter shifts in a dramatic way, when your relationship goes from subjugating to supposedly subjugating a subject in your painting to it being you, and that moment where the viewer all of a sudden can kind of reinterpret your history because, you know, the male chest is revealed and the fetish is kind of clarified, and then you have to go back and you have to look at all the things that precede it. And I think that art historically, we all know trajectories, they're collapsed at this point because they are canonized, but we know trajectories in which historically all of that preceded becomes immediately redefined by something at some stage that's understood in an artist. And that seems to relate very much to the arc of this personal thing that you will always be working with. Does it effectively, because it seems like on an aesthetic level in some ways, it effectively changed the way the painting is constructed. Does it forever put that away? Do those veils that could have been mushrooms or grids or colors or beauty or technique or skill, all of these things that you're really masterful with, once you can be honest to certain subject issue phenomena going on in your life, does it eliminate those things or in fact, you know, like not transgender issues, not you and your dynamic with your wife, not fetish or sexuality, is there still a part of like the Matt Green that's like the colors and the grid and the space and the pretty?
Well, I mean, on a certain level, I would answer your question by with the resounding, I have no clue. There's also a point at which I feel like...
But it seems like reconciliation with certain issues on a personal level and also on a kind of technical level do exist in the art. So it's like, I would argue to say that you could probably, not to undermine your kind of leaving everything open for the circumstances of your life, but predicting certain things, sometimes we resolve things.
Yeah.
And then we feel that we've moved beyond. We're, you know, and we can be our own tricksters 10 years later and find out you didn't resolve shit, you're right back in the same place, but we at least imagine that we resolved them because we've decided to let them go, be it,
yeah.
You know, the grid's not there, or the amount of white space. To speak about this one picture,
right.
Things aren't happening that might have made magical other veiled subjects before.
I would say, though, that sure, there's a lot of things that I feel are resolved and I would shed. There's other things which I feel like the I feel like there's a certain part of me that wants to see the variety of textures in an old growth forest in my mm-hmm. painting, and to see things, you know, break a limb off and have to like grow a little knot of scar tissue. Like I feel like there's a certain part of me that is like wants the painting to be a process of building up and tearing down, and like I don't feel like I need to put a picture of a mushroom in it to get that across, but I feel like this sort of struggle I've had over the years of like how to make a painting has so colored the way that I make a painting that I'm not going to make like a finish painting, and that it like I say, like I'm struggling with the idea of printing a photo. Just, I've also done every single thing myself in terms of making the work and never have used assistants or anything. And it actually sort of pains me to like go to a lab and hand someone something and say like print this bit. Like seems so abstract and so not like the gradual accumulation of experiences that I look for. So I would say that even though some things might change, there's other things which are not going to change. Like there's a certain point at which you are who you are. You're sort of like, no matter how much, for example, if you're trying to change your body, there's a certain point at which your body is just your body, and whatever you do to it, it's like,
although was funny to be in your studio last week in New York and see that you had ripped a bunch of canvas off the surface of a bunch of paintings, and there was the grid underneath, and that it actually was really different.
Yeah.
And that your surfaces were suddenly just really different and conflicted and actually more variegated. I mean, like, I like Charlie's question a lot because it also kind of brings back this question of the forest and the organic and the ways in which there's something about, you know, Nick's question, like, these are not crowds, because crowds are variegated, and there's all kinds of different sizes and shapes and colors of people, do you know what I mean? And that these are absolutely the opposite of a crowd, in a sense. It's the crowd in your mind. It's the pulsing of your mind to
right.
see a thing, to see it, but it is, there's a replication that does happen that's, you're saying, like the filmic gaze, much more like the filmic gaze than the submersion of the self in a crowd of the unknown, and that there is something exciting in you tearing the canvas off, and then there was still a grid underneath, and I
right.
guess that's what I'm like, there's always going to be a grid underneath,
right.
so we can just accept that, and maybe we really are all born wearing high heels, and it's just that, you know what I mean, like barefoot is actually pretend, and, you know,
right.
because...
Vivian Westwood said something like that, about how a woman wearing high heels is the most beautiful thing in nature, or something like
that. Well, it makes me think of, going back to Charlie's questions, I didn't have that question because it seemed to me that a painting is like a fetish. I go back to that thing you said about when they talked about, you know, these are things for hedge funders, and not to totally dismiss that question as being like a dismissal of your practice, but as to say that like these things are like beautiful and like and desirable as paintings, as well as like, you know, depicting objects of desire or whatever. But it seemed that aspect seemed to like really coalesce.
I mean, to go back to Charlie, like I say, I don't know what the answer to your question is, and that's the thing that gets me up in the morning and makes me want to go to the studio is that I don't know, I have to do something physical over time to let a physical act accumulate over time to do the thinking that enables that freedom, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that in the repetition of, you know, the same body in one space sets up, whether it's intentional or not, has the potential to set up a standard? Because that's sometimes what I feel like, aside from your own particular, you know,
mm-hmm.
like every artist has the right to prefer a certain whatever
uh-huh.
aesthetic choice, like a certain kind of high heel or a certain kind of leg shape or height
uh-huh.
of a person, but that in some ways, kind of the way that photography and film does, it does, the replication sets up the aura of a standard.
Mm-hmm.
And that seems to me to be the opposite in some ways of what can happen in nature, like you were talking about. A limb breaks off and a gnarled bump has to appear.
But then a pine tree makes a pine tree.
Pine tree makes a pine tree and pine tree. So yeah, I was just wondering, because it seems like both that you're setting both things up. There was something about a...
I like being in between those things.
Uh-huh.
There's something, it's interesting, I've just been thinking about kind of the kind of organic process that was Darger's manner of making armies of girls, and the kind of singularity of the one, it could be, you know, an ideal kind of erotic fantasy is soldiering something, because the notion of the soldier is that uniformity. So you kind of soldier the girls, or you soldier yourself, and you soldier the little girls, and you made them because that is, you know, and I think obviously that's clear in art, but became crystal clear with like Lenny Riefenstahl, like the way that image operates, that you're soldiering something. And I think that thinking about that immediately relates to the fact that that is about standard, but it is also about the fact that like that cloning or that uniformity is goes back to a fetish where this is it and it's right and I want lots of it, you know? I don't want the variety. If it
right.
was variety fetish,
right.
it would manifest itself literally as variety fetish.
It's more, for me, it's more like ritual fetish, and it's like I say, that it's like, it's predominantly me and, you know, the occasional sprinkling of people that I have close relationships with. But, so like, to be more revealing about myself and the way that I work, like to get the way that this photo, like when I work with other people, I sort of, you have to plan it out in advance and you have to have some idea of what is gonna happen when you're there. When I take pictures of myself, I generally don't say, all right, on Thursday I'm gonna take photos and I do this. What I actually do is I take photos every day. Like the first thing I do when I get to the studio is I like take a series of photos of myself in some form. So it's like after a month of doing that, then this was, the photos in this picture were like the only ones that seemed like I wanted to show to anyone, you know what I mean? Like, so there's like, it's as much about ritual and like trying to understand myself or what's consistent or what's inconsistent with the, like.
And I think that that again, that like that you're bringing up the word ritual comes through, I guess, a lot more potently for me in the pictures that, in the paintings that start after you introduced yourself into them, I guess, because the reason why I brought up standard is because it becomes more problematic for the artist and the viewer when it's images of women, because we are already accustomed to the standards, and so why Roberta Smith might be able to even make the comment that she made is because it's harder to find the ritual, which ritual means magic toward transformation and change. I mean, that's what it's for, is to change something. Mm-hmm. And so harder to find the ritual in what could feel like,
or to keep something the same.
Or to keep something the same. Okay. I'll have to think about that. But just that the ritual, that it was hard to see, anyway, a ritual of changing a standard we're already familiar with about the way that women, you know, are represented.
What I would say to that is the thing that's so funny to me is like, of course I understand what you're saying on a theoretical level, and I am so fully aware of the critique of, you know, male standards of female beauty. The thing that's funny to me is I actually, and the thing that I'm always trying to figure out some way to say in my work, is that I actually don't, I mean, my personal experience in my personal life is not that I have any like certain physical attribute that I look for in people, and it's actually I mean, sure, there's some point at which I have like, there might be some things that I'm like more drawn to than others, like but sort of like most of my like fetishistic interests, you know, are not in what the person looks like, but that they're in their willingness to take part in the fetishization of the shoe. And it's like, it's the wearing of the thing,
mm-hmm.
and not the body type that I've been
mm-hmm.
trying to like
right.
isolate, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I'm just affirming your statements earlier, how difficult it is to represent that to the world and have it be viewed on the terms that you're interested in.
Right.
You know, I mean, I'm just reminded, like a long time ago, I was living in New York, you know, and I was performing at these clubs where there's a lot of male comics, you know,
mm-hmm.
and they, you know, kind of the thing that they were always talking about female comics was, you know, Pretty Women Can't Be Funny. And it was just this weird thing that stuck out, you know, that I, you know, that you always have to think about as a female artist presenting yourself in the world. You know what I mean? And so that thing of which standards can you break, and then which standards are you suddenly required to uphold?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, now how do I take that on? Can I? Should I? Don't I? You know what I mean? So that there's this conflicting way that you represent what's in your brain versus how it comes
mm-hmm.
out. Anyway.
But it gets to something that's not, like, one thing, especially because your additional veils or your translation of an image of the self onto the canvas via Xerox, via painting it, like, if something borders on the passable, if it's obscured any further, the complication could disappear.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that in a way, if you kind of were to kind of, for comedic purposes, outwardly further narrativize the critique that you were given, how about the person who bought the, you know, who obtains or desires the work because of a subjective relationship to what they think they're looking at in their mental masturbation? What happens at the break point when they find out, well, that's Matt? You know,
exactly.
You know, what happens there? And that's, you know, that's, I mean, it's
right.
not your intention. And I think the action is going on in the process of making the work, but it definitely is a kind of result or problem that comes from images.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that in fact, the complication is, of course, the success of passability is a desire of the person who's trying to coexist or exist in society in that way. But if there is an actual critique going on by someone who's working with the subject matter, one actually has to index it.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't make a point of it when you're
right.
trying to actually speak about it to some degree, it could disappear.
Mm-hmm.
But that's no different than almost any other, to me, what you started with kind of not agreeing with, I think, is set some precedence, which is to say that work that exists within theoretical frameworks that require an understanding outside of what might be between the viewer and the object or the viewer and the image require that additional information.
Mm-hmm.
So it to activate it, if you will. So in a way, over a long period of time, an image like this seems to reactivate a lot of your prior work.
Right.
But
well,
all works seem to be still very, like, extremely fetishistic and still
mm-hmm.
really, you know, imitative of the idealized female body, even if you were sort of the primary actor. Whereas this more recent work has a certain awkward quality in a way. I mean, it's interesting to sort of compare it with the older work and think about how, in a way, it doesn't, you know, recreate that longing and desire for an idealized, you know, feminine body. It has a certain quality about it. I mean, just, you know, the musculature of the figure and how it's so apparently different and awkward. And part of that, I think, is just the, in a sense, you're sort of coming out with photography and with sort of the body as real body versus idealized body. And, I mean, you don't really have, I mean, I find the older work just as pleasurable in the sense of, you know, in a sense, as Tanya was saying, I mean, we're all about the male gaze in the sense that there's something pleasurable in that body for everyone. But this is really interesting in that it upends that pleasure. And
well,
I mean, I'm wondering what sort of general reaction, because it seems like people would come to expect a certain thing of your work based on the older work. And besides all the sort of, coming out as a cross-dresser, there's just like an aesthetic quality about this work that's really different. Much more kind of individualistic, less, you know, sort of group and pattern and repetition oriented.
Mm-hmm. Going back to what Charlie said, like, about, I mean, now I'm, you know, whatever my evolution as an artist has been to, like, put these things on the table and to talk about them, and I mean, that's why I'm here talking to you today. But I have to say that when I first started showing as an artist, I have to say that I actually totally got off on the idea that these, like, hedge fund managers were buying what they thought was a painting of a hot chick and that it was me. And I was like, yeah, the joke's on you, and only I get it. I have to say that at the time, that really had enough of a thrill to me, like, and then it's only been you know, over the years of like working as an artist and like needing to have a community of people that I can talk to about it. Like, I actually really don't care what collectors think about my art. Like, I'm glad that they buy it, but my audience is like, is you in this room, like, are the people that I want to talk to about it. And there's a level at which I actually am like, don't consider the people who buy my art the audience for my art. Which is, you know, totally problematic and screwed up, and I'll admit it, but it is the way it is.
I like that this is up at the Armory right now. We want to hear what the shoppers think. You know what I mean? Because it is.
What the shoppers?
Well, you know, that's what the, I'm sorry, but yeah. And because it is, it's going to be, you know, it's a different collector that's going to buy this. It just is. You know, I mean, on a more superficial level, as that goes.
Are there any last questions?
I guess I'm curious about how in an announcement card, like in a way that for a show, your last Perez project show, like that those images on the poster were the most direct images you've ever shown.
Mm-hmm.
And it comes not in a painting, but it comes in an announcement card.
That you get for free.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes. But what do you, what, yes,
yeah. What's the question?
Why did you reserve that moment to sort of be that direct? In a poster, an announcement card.
Because I had already made all the work for the show, and then I had felt like, well.
But even a piece like this, I guess, which would come after that.
I feel like it's less direct than that, and
yeah, it goes back to a more veiled and ambiguous kind of terrain, and it's just fascinating to see, you know, that poster, which I look at all the time. There's Matt, but that's the only art. That's the only piece. It's not an artwork. It's like that. So I'm just curious about the decision to sort of like in that moment, that you want to do it there, but you still don't. You don't want to do it in the work, where there's like a kind of dress, the beard, and a beard, or a 5 o'clock shadow, kind of like a very male, you know. That's a guy with a good ass.
Do you think it served as a way to it's kind of great to reserve it for the advertising for the show, because then walking in, the conversation's already begun, do you think? It's like a...
I wanted people to look at those paintings and know that that was what was behind it.
Right.
But on my day-to-day, the thing is, on my day-to-day, like, on my day-to-day life, like, I wake up in the morning and I have to do something with my day. And, like I say, I can't just hand someone a photograph and say, print this. Like, I actually need the struggle in my life of hacking away at the painting to reach that comfort.
But is there something about in the art that it needs to have this kind of ambiguity to sort of, like, you know, kind of be radiant? And
well, no, it's like it's just for my experience of it. Like, I need to like struggle with it.
Like, I guess how awkward question would be, how does that poster fail as an artwork? How could it never be an artwork? Because it's a series of figures across a kind of plain the way you kind of generally structure a painting.
Mm-hmm. I don't know.
I get what you're getting at. I feel like, I think that one part, and from what you've said, I feel like, do you feel that like that sort of direct address, from what you've said, I feel like you think that that's a lie, that like that, well, or that the,
it's
that,
not that
directness
it's,
isn't, it doesn't have some sort of like real life authenticity, that this complexity of life and this like constant messiness and this constant living and dying and fixing and falling apart is what you really believe in. Yeah,
I guess I mean to like, I don't, that's not exactly what I mean. I mean more like to take a picture, to take that picture of me in a maid's outfit with a sword that was on that invitation. I've taken in my life about 50,000 pictures of me in a maid's outfit with a sword to get to that, over years, to take that one. And you don't see that struggle in when you see that image. And that what I'm trying to do in the paintings is to show the struggle and not just the image. Like, I want to show the image and the struggle behind the image. And maybe that's like melodramatic. Sure, like I will admit it. I mean,
yeah.
It seems like it's how you define struggle that seems confusing. Cause to me, it seems like the biggest struggle is you finding a way to be direct or to come to terms with something that you think is humiliating or has like a certain level of like risk through directness. And the fact that you've made 50,000 images of you in a maid's dress is like, that's not doing nothing. So then talking about the struggle in terms of like a material sort of like working on a painting, it's a different type of struggle, but I wonder which one's like the more like the real struggle behind the work, because to me it seems more like a conceptual struggle that you're talking about that might come through more in the photographs than they do in some of the paintings. I don't know.
I mean, so you know, it's funny to me, like, I mean, I'm very stubborn, and I feel like a lot of people tell me like that they like my photos better than my paintings, and I just have to do both, like I and
yeah, it seems like it all informs each other. I mean, it's easy to say, having seen both, well, I like this better, this makes more sense, but without having all that information displayed for us, it's impossible to really have that perspective. So it's what you're saying makes a lot of sense. It's like, I need the story, I need the painting, I need the photographs, I need all the different kinds of photographs from different years to kind of get the broader picture.
I mean, and like I say, I mean, I don't pretend to be like in a position of knowing the correct way to make art, and the, like, I think that art is only interesting when it has the opportunity to fail, and that any image is a failed representation of what, like maybe part of my mistrust of showing photographs is that the aspect of failure is not addressed in it, or something, for like from me, my photographs, not like photography in general, but I mean, maybe my next show is going to be all photographs.
Well, some of the photographs are borrowing from, they seem like they've learned things from the